And I believe that this is something that we have said yes to Avalon. We didn't know how this was going to unfold. Of course, when we said yes, we thought it was going to be right there in that near future. And there is a different divine plan for us. And Star Wolf and I are very, very grateful that everyone continue to be in their heart and trusting and moving with a kindness and acceptance and understanding that, especially in our tribe, where we have such a high level of understanding of spirituality, to understand that is divine time. And of course, this is not what we said yes to in a conscious level, but it was what we said yes to in the spirit. And so the intention that Star Wolf and I had to bring us together today in a special day is because we do want to continue to feel that we are one tribe, we are still breathing together inside of this yes. And the thought of bringing Maria is because Maria is going to be one of our guides when we are in England. And to me, besides being a special friend, she is truly someone that, if anyone goes to England, I don't know if everybody can be with her, but those that can will be blessed. You know, she is a druid priestess, and she is one of the authorities in ley lines and geodetic energy in England, and not only England, because she has been in Egypt and other sacred lands, studying the ley lines. And because, you know, she has been teaching dowsing and past life regressions and tarot and astrology, the sacred astrology, for over 23 years, she is invited to go to the sacred places and with the group explore the vibrations. And it's kind of a fun experience when we are with her, because she brings us not only the knowledge of the place, but to experience the places in this deep level, energetically speaking. And her father, you know, was a master dowser in England. And so, of course, she was initiated in a young age. And nothing that I can say here about Maria is going to really express who she is for me and for everyone that knows her. She's very knowledgeable, and so grateful, Maria, that you are here with us today, gifting us the presence of your wisdom and guiding us into this short journey through the sacred places in UK. Welcome, Maria. Welcome. Thank you for being here.
And welcome to you all, and thank you. And that was a lovely introduction, Vera, so thank you for that. But what I'm going to do in a moment is I'm going to open up a PowerPoint, and we're going to journey to Stonehenge and Avebury and Avalon, and we're going to be having a look at some of the energies. And if we have time, we're going to touch upon a really beautiful energy device from ancient Egypt that is very healing. And because we're living in these times, I thought if I have time, I will add that on. This is going to be very open, very informal. If you feel, for example, that you want to add to something, say something, please do, because, you know, it's about us and not just about me talking. So, or you could save a question to the end, or kind of join in and say, well, what about this, Maria? So I'm really open to however you feel that you want to approach me in that. So I thought I'd mention that at the beginning, because it's important that we share. And you may have a feeling about even looking at parts of Stonehenge. Also, I'm going to be revealing some new discoveries at Stonehenge that I've had with an engineer and a mathematician, where we've decoded the early part of Stonehenge and a very feminine sacred ritual there that was done on a particular night. It's called the Night of the High Moon. And I don't know if you've heard about the Night of the High Moon, but you're going to. So we're going to have some fun thinking about the goddess aspect of Stonehenge and other sites as well. So I'm going to start screen sharing now. Let's get that going. And let's go to enlarging it. I've had a few issues today. There we go. So we're going to go to Avery first of all, and we can see here that there's some standing stones in the top. They're called the Cove Stones. And below, we have Avery. Avery welcomes everyone. She's the largest stone circle in the world. She has 100 standing stones going around the outside and two very large circles, stone circles towards the center, called the Northern Inner Circle and the Southern Inner Circle. And I can remember being with Vera, and we were at the Cove Stones. So I put this in honor of Vera's knowledge about Avery as well. So the top, those silhouetted stones, one of them is huge. She weighs over 100 tons. And Vera was saying to put the womb against it. Can you remember that, Vera? And a lot of people put their bellies, as it were, against the stone and felt the energy there. She is like the mother of Avery. So it's always good to introduce ourselves to the Cove Stones. And they stand in the Northern Inner Circle, the Temple of the Moon. Below, we see an aerial shot that I took of Avebury, just to show you the huge size of it. She covers 28 acres and is surrounded by an earthwork called a henge. A henge has a ditch on the inside and a bank on the outside, and it gleamed chalk white 4,500 years ago, echoing the Milky Way above Great Circle, the two, celestial and earth, joining together. So she would have been brilliant white, but people see it grassed over these days. So she was really spectacular. And when we look to the left-hand side, the way I'm looking at my screen, we see some energies. And I want us to have a look at the energies, which we'll be going into detail with, because when we think about ley lines, and I'm sure we've all heard about ley lines, haven't we? Yeah. They're a straight line with ancient sites placed upon them. But that isn't necessarily the power in the land, because geomancers from thousands of years ago in China most definitely documented that you had a ley line that was surrounded and entwined by two currents. So imagine a line like that and then being entwined by two currents. One is male and one is female, and they're the yin and yang. So imagine now a ley line that has a caduceus-like symbol associated to it, or a strand of DNA that Gaia admits. That's called a ley system. And ley systems are truly the power in the land. And what we see at Avebury and Glastonbury, for example, both are associated with the St. Michael ley line, which is pink on this diagram. And then entwining it are the Mary and Michael currents. And they're called Mary and Michael because in the 1980s, rather, Hamish Miller and Paul Broadhurst doused that ley line. And they discovered that every 8 kilometers, roughly speaking, on the female earth current, there was churches dedicated to Mother Mary or Mary Magdalene. So they called it the Mary current. And on the male current, there was lots of churches dedicated to Michael predominantly, or George. So they called that the Michael current. So it's clear that even after the kind of prehistoric era of the ancient past, Christians and Templars and the Druids were all adding to this system. And the living, sentient earth energies of Gaia, these yin and yang currents, can be likened to solar and lunar. The solar energies can affect the Michael current, and lunar energies can affect the Mary current. And at Avebury, they do something so very special, nowhere else in the world. I'm going to show you these currents globally in a moment. At Avebury, at the entrance to the main site, there's two huge portal stones. Imagine them like guardians standing. You have to walk through them to enter the sanctity of the inner stone circles. And that's where Mary and Michael co-join like this. And they flow together, male and female, united all the way through the sites of the two inner stone circles that I previously described, bringing a kind of union pure balance. If you walk these energy lines, you can walk them in the balance, or you can choose to walk the feminine, or you can choose to walk the masculine. And that's what I do to people. And if we walk into Avebury from through these earth energies, then we're walking in the footsteps of our ancestors. So I don't take you around Avebury like the tourists just walk around. I take you in the footsteps of the ancestors to experience the ancient past, how they would have interacted with the site. And here we have two ley lines that are very famous in England. And I'm going to be showing you one that I studied in a moment. We have the Belinus line. That's the huge north-south line. That too is encoiled by two earth energies, male and female, called Ellen and Belinus. And an author called Gary Biltcliffe writes about these two currents. And I've been dowsing with Gary for over 20 something years now. And then on the diagram of the south of England, we have the Michael line with entwining by the earth currents as well. And Glastonbury, for example, is at the point of the St. Michael ley line, flows through the Tor, and Mary and Michael wrap around the Tor. Imagine now they're going to meet, they're going round and round that Tor, and they co-join almost like, as Hamish describes it, in a sexual embrace like this, right at the top. So some people interpret Glastonbury Tor to be a very fertile site, the mind of the imagination, and to manifest and conceive ideas as well. So the way the Mary Michael currents flow can indicate for some how you can interact with the site, but it's always a good idea to go with your own heart and your own feelings about where you are anyway. And they are so strong on Glastonbury Tor that only just people watch. If you're at the tower, for example, spend a couple of minutes people watching, and they all go to a particular point, and that'll be just in front of the edge, and that's where the currents kind of meet. And people intuitively go to these points because the energy of the land draws us towards it, and that's it. It's a very beautiful beautiful feeling on Glastonbury Tor. And here we are with Glastonbury Tor, and we can see there's what's called ridges, lynchets, as they're called here, and there are seven that wrap around the Tor. There have been many interpretations of these kind of lynchets, as they're called, from growing crops, which I doubt it, to representing the entrance into the other world of the Fae, of the Celts. And it does, as we see later, match an earth energy current and force in the land that is the most powerful form of earth energy that we have a look at. And we also have Mary flowing down the center of Glastonbury Abbey. The first church there was a circular church dedicated from Joseph of Arimathea to Mother Mary. And it was a beautiful circular church, the first in all of Christendom. And that was at the kind of far end. The reason why we have these feminine churches and dedications is because of the earth current. So Mary flows all the way down that axis line, and she does something very special. She pulses like a heartbeat going down that axis line, and she pulses out seven times that can equate to our chakras. So going down the axis line of Glastonbury Abbey, one can open up their chakras. And if you imagine that the most holiest of holies is the high altar in Christendom. And at the high altar, that represents the crown chakra. And just before that, you would have the third eye. And King Arthur's relocated grave with Queen Guinevere is at the heart chakra as well. So you can walk down the axis line, opening up the chakra system, because the way Christianity does it today, when you're born, certainly in the British Isles, you have a cross of water from a font placed above your third eye chakra. But unless all of the other chakras are opened, it's not necessarily the best way to be introduced. The royals of high society and the aristocracy, for instance, have long, long walls for their christening of their children, where they activate the child, the future king, if you will, or the future queen, through opening up the chakra system at birth. And Glastonbury Abbey was very unique because it was its own country, like the City of London. Okay, so the City of London Financial Institute is its own country, and Glastonbury used to be its own country, and it was very, very wealthy. And that's why one of our mad kings, Henry VIII, decided to demolish and steal and ransack Glastonbury Abbey, which was you know, awful thing to do. So today it is ruinous, but the energy there will open up your chakra system and invite you into the higher mysteries of Avalon. When we look at Mary and Michael combined, because they're never more than 5 miles away from each other, which I told Hamish Miller, who discovered them, I think that's because the ley line keeps them together in an ancient long-lost technology. But together, Robert Kuhn discovered that they represent the rainbow serpent, which lots of people have heard about and worked with. So Mary and Michael go from the heart chakra, which is believed to be Glastonbury, right the way through to Uluru, Ayers Rock, which represents, for example, the solar plexus worldwide, and Lake Titicaca, which again is one of the chakras. So worldwide, these two currents flow, bringing the energy of Glastonbury, bringing the energy of Avebury worldwide flowing. There is no separation with ancient site energies when we look at them globally, because as we'll see later, they contain memory of place like the Akashic records as well. And that was discovered before Hamish Miller and Paul Broadhurst discovered the Mary and Michael currents. Robert Kuhn is currently living in Australia, and I had the great pleasure of studying with him in Glastonbury going back to about 1990. So I was very privileged looking back. So what I want to kind of express and embrace with this diagram is that all of the currents flow and interact with one another. And when we are at the ancient sites, as I'm sure as Vera and Star Wolf have experienced and expressed, that we're a part of all of this system. So it's always a good idea as a druid, as Vera explained, I'm a druid priestess, that when we go to these sites, we tell the site what we're going to do. So if I take a group there, I tell Avery, I'm bringing a group here. And everybody says their intent. So the site knows what you're doing, the energies know what you're doing. And it's a communication, which we'll see will be memorized by you. So that's what druids do. They just kind of communicate, you know, what they are going to do at an ancient site. So that's a ley system with a ley line and the two earth currents entwining them, which incidentally can be very healing. Mary can expand your third eye and your kind of feminine side and nurturing and be very soothing. Both are very soothing, whereas Michael can be slightly energizing, still healing, but represents the solar aspect of ourselves. So if we wanted courage, recuperation from an illness, a male earth current would be kind of ideal in a way. My late father inherited all the unpublished surveys of a master dowser called Guy Underwood. And I've obviously inherited them now. And Guy Underwood was a very good master dowser. He was also, like myself, studied archaeology to give that like, kind of left-right brain aspect. And what Guy discovered was at ancient sites at the esoteric center, because as we know that if you go to Stonehenge or Avebury, the central features, the central megalithic features are never ever at the geometric center. They're always off center. And this has baffled archaeologists for centuries, actually, because they say, why couldn't they have put it in the geometric center? It's because they were looking for this energy pattern rising from the earth. Imagine deep down that you have two types of water. One type of water that we're all familiar with, and don't I know it, living in England today, we've had a torrential downpour, a thunderstorm, and it's summer. That type of water falls from the sky and fills up the aquifers and the underground streams, and that's called young water. And it can be a bit problematic to live above. But there's another type of water that my late father taught me about. It's yin water, and that's water perpetually born within the womb of Gaia. And this water is very deep, and it produces this energy pattern called a geospiral, which commonly has seven coils, and it also equates to the heart chakra. This type of water is really powerful because it can force a ley line to slightly veer off. It can force an earth current to suddenly veer off. It really is the power in the land. And this is what the ancients were looking for worldwide. And even 25 years ago, when I used to do tours with my late father, we were talking about this type of yin water. And now the Russians have gone down 7 miles and have found underground water, which surprised them. And it's really pure. And what are we made of? We're made up of water. So when we interact with this type of energy, we can also heal and cleanse our own body water as well. And more than that, this type of water has strong memory. We know through homeopathy, don't we, that water has memory. It's very common for that to be known. And this type of water holds on to the Akashic record of place. Everyone that's ever been there, everything that's ever happened at Avebury, Stonehenge, the pyramids, site after site after site will memorize through this energy symbol of the geospiral and the deep water beneath. And that's what the ancients were looking for. And it's called the esoteric center of an ancient site. And it is very a pure place to enter. And so what I often suggest to people, again, I always say go with what your own heart feels, but what I kind of feel maybe a good idea when we're going to enter this kind of yin water energy field is to introduce yourself to the site. She's going to memorize you. So make it a really beautiful experience. You know, say your name, say your intent, how you feel. And it's because it's very, very powerful, and it's rising up from 7, 10, 15, 20, 30 miles beneath Gaia's surface and rising all the way up is a real joy. I've measured this with some scientists, one of whom is called Rodney Hale, and it gives off a 7 hertz frequency. And that puts your brain instantly into alpha mode. So you feel good around this energy system. And more beautifully, which I really love, is that the Schumann, quite close to the Schumann resonance, although it can go up the Schumann resonance, which is often likened to Gaia's heartbeat. So everything comes together within that 7 hertz healing field, and loads of people feel that, they sense that at places that have this very deep underground yin water, purest feminine water on the planet. Now, when we have holy wells, for example, and there are numerous places all across southern England and in Wales and Scotland, can't leave the British Isles out, otherwise we get into trouble with our Irish friends, well, my Irish friends anyway, all across Ireland. That's where they're tapping in to part of that holy water that's eking up through the normal aquifer water, and it makes it very healing. For instance, What Guy Underwood did, that master dowser that discovered this, he listened to all of the veteran stories from people that survived the Second World War. And a similar theme was coming through. You see, animals know what's good for them. It's kind of us that some of us have a disconnect with the earth, and we are just remembering the past wisdoms. But cattle, horses, sheep, wherever they lie, they tend to be on good earth energy and quite often on a similar spiral pattern of underground, smaller pockets of water, not necessarily a massive lake and aquifer like you get at the pyramids and Avebury and Stonehenge. But they're sleeping above it. And in the night, to these soldiers that must have been in fear mode, they must have been tired, a woman would come to them. It could be their lover, their mother, their gran, their aunt, their sister, and tell them they would be okay. And also it was noticed by Bernadette, who was the young girl, she was 15 at the time. She saw the Blessed Virgin Mary, the goddess in front of her. And she started scratching at the ground in France. And she put the earth in her mouth and retched. And she did that until the waters, the healing waters of Lourdes, birth forced and came up to the ground and created the world, one of the world's most holiest healing springs at Lourdes in France. So I've always said that associated with this energy pattern is the likelihood of you seeing the goddess aspect of creation, and she will come to you in the guise that is safe for you. So for Bernadette, for example, it was the Blessed Virgin Mary. She was a Catholic. For me and others, we see what's called the White Lady. And the White Lady is associated with underground water and wells all across our mythology and our legends of this land. So for me, it could be the White Lady. And for the servicemen in the army, rather, it was their beloved women. So this is a portal, if you will, to opening up to meeting and sometimes visually seeing an aspect of the goddess. And like I say, I'm kind of the Celtic blood and mythologies. So I probably would see Caridwen or Bridget or Arianrod or Rhiannon, for example, because they are my goddesses. But she will come to you in your own way. And so if you ask, when you are over these energy points, like this geospiral, ask, and sometimes you are given a key to that wonderful experience. This is Silbury Hill, where Vera takes people, and it's a wonderful, wonderful mound. It's the largest man-made mound in Northwest Europe, and she graces the Avebury environs. She's about a mile away from Avebury, and we always go here. Now, imagine, remember I said the Henge Bank was originally white. Beneath that grass veneer, which is 4,500 years old, imagine there's a 7-step pyramid that was eventually smoothed over in white chalk. This was a gleaming white chalk monument, similar to how, if you will, the pyramids were finished off in limestone and allegedly capped with gold. And I think of a similar thing here. It was whitened off with the chalk, and it could have had some copper plate at the top of it, or even gold. So it would be like a capacitor and emitting energy I'll talk about later. But in a planetary ley system that I have studied, I've shown you two guys take on ley lines, Hamish Miller with the St. Michael line, Gary Billcliffe with the Belinus line. Now you're going to see my research on what's called the planetary ley system. So we see Silbury, this beautiful monument, as being earth in a ley system, I'll show you in a moment. But 4,500 years ago, when Silbury was in pristine condition, she was surrounded by a moat of water. So now imagine that Silbury is like an island, like the Isle of Avalon was because it's low-lying land in Glastonbury, that got reclaimed by the Dutch in the 1700s. And lots of London were islands as well, like Battersea and Chelsea, the Isle of Dogs. They're all like little islands. So it wasn't just the Isle of Avalon. This would have been like an island as well. And you would have walked across it on what's called a causeway. And it was quite deep, fed by 81 springs. And even today in the winter, when the water table rises up, this fills with water. And the beauty of it is, to in creed of our late ancestors, the tip of the top of that mound reflects perfectly right at the end. So you see a mirror image of Silbury in the water. And that's a real sight to behold. It's beautiful. When we have a look at this planetary lay system, we see on my left, sometimes Zoom becomes a bit of a mirror, it's the other way around, that's why I say my left. This is an ancient lay system that was discovered or rediscovered by the Reverend Edward Duke, who lived not far from Stonehenge. In fact, I don't know if you've heard of Sting, he's a famous rock star. He ended up living in that house, actually. It's a massive Edwardian mansion house, very, very beautiful, quintessentially English in design. So we have this ley line going down, and right at the bottom, we have the Temple of Stonehenge on the orbit of Saturn. Now, Saturn takes about 29 to 30 years to do one circuit around, and Stonehenge has 30 stones going round, which represent the orbit of Saturn. When we move up that ley line, we come to an amazing Druid site called Casterly Camp. It's the largest Druid site in Europe, and it represents the orbit of Jupiter, according to this very ancient map. And Jupiter is the largest planet, reflecting the largest Druid center, which incidentally was a Corm, that's C-O-R, and a Druid core represents a university. So all the Druids and the ancient people used to gather to get knowledge and exchange knowledge, just like we're doing here. This would be like a Druid core. As we move up that ley line, we come to the orbit of Mars, and it no longer exists, but the Temple of Marden, den is an old English word for settlement, farmstead, Marden, the settlement of Mars, was the largest superhenge in the area. It had a sweat lodge, it had stone circles, it had a massive mound like Silbury Hill, but unfortunately it got ploughed out in the 1800s and broken down. And all that exists today are some what's called earthworks. That's like the henge bank you can see in place. But energetically, it is still there. It is still the Temple of Mars. We move up and we come to a long barrow, and I'll be showing you some long barrows later, which is the orbit of Mercury. Then we move up and we have the Temple of the Sun and the Moon, which is Avery's northern and inner circle. Silbury anchors that, and towards the top we have Venus, the Temple of Venus, which was a beautiful concentric stone circle about 10 miles or so away from Avebury. They got completely destroyed apart from one stone in the 1724 onwards, which was, you know, a real sad and loss of the area. But I showed this to an astronomer friend because I said, well, that's the seven known planets. Where are the modern day planets, if you will, like Uranus, Neptune and Pluto, because I'm sure our ancient ancestors would have added sites to those places. And he looked at this map and he was really astonished. He said what the ancients were doing is they were using Silbury Hill, going using the mean distance in the heavens above and applying that to that map. So they must have known the mean distance of all of the planets, which has only been known within the last 100 years, calculated and not made accurate till NASA did some studies. So our ancient ancestors were master astronomers extraordinaire. And what they were doing, so they anchored in Earth with Silbury Hill and then used these measurements. So using that same system, an astronomer friend of mine, he used that measurement and was found the orbit of Uranus, and I'll show you that in a moment, and the site that's associated with it. And poetically, the ancients put the orbit of Neptune, and Neptune is god of the seas, like Poseidon, right on the south coast, overlooking the seas. So this system links Stonehenge to Avebury and all of these sites with the planetary energy above. Sites, all of those planets aligned above that ley line, above those signs in 2700 BC, and activated all of those energies at the site. So just by tuning in to the planets at these sites, we can really gain a lot of information, knowledge, exchange. And some people get downloads from these sites. So the beautiful barrow, which is north of Avebury, it's a horned barrow. This is where Uranus was, going right the way down. So the ancients were fully aware of where Uranus was, for example. And it has what's called a false entrance. So what you're looking at is the false entrance, which you get, incidentally, in ancient Egypt. In all of the tombs there, you'd have a false entrance. It's where the ancient Egyptians believed you had two aspects to the soul, the ka and the ba. One was the personality, one was the soul. And before they entered the field of reeds, which was their heaven, they could come in and out the kind of personality aspect of the soul through the false entrance there. So it's a wonderful ancient site that represents the energy of Uranus, and it's a really wondrous place in Gloucestershire. Now we're going to come and have a look at the energy of the megaliths themselves, which we always experience at ancient sites, and it is a wonder to do this, actually. Now, imagine that a standing stone is rooted into earth energy, poof, like an acupuncture needle on a meridian line. What a standing stone is, it's identical to a semiconductor from Silicon Valley. There's no difference on the inside of that crystal lattice structure. The lattice structure is identical to a semiconductor, and a semiconductor can receive energy, it can memorize energy, and it can push it out again. That's what is in our laptops and is in most technology. And what the ancients were fully aware of is that if you place that energy into that stone, rather into the ground, because you must remember the stone is rooted into the ground, into the chalk bedrock, for example, for Avebury and Stonehenge. And once they're rooted into that earth energy, rising up will be the earth energy that the stone is absorbing through its crystal lattice structure, and it makes these energy bands that spiral around the stone, for example, of which there are seven. Two are underground, and there's five above ground on a large standing stone. And these band number two, the heart chakra of the stone, can push out an energy line, because it's drawing the earth energy up, and now it's transmitting it out. And it does that through the heart to every other stone in that stone circle. It could be crossways, it could be going around the stone circle. Every stone communicates through its heart chakra to every other stone in a complex. And then we move up to the throat chakra and the third eye, and the crown's rather high, obviously on a very large standing stone. Now, it was my late father did a lot of work into these energies being emitted by the standing stones. And I decided I was either going to prove it one way or the other, because when I was doing tours, it doesn't look a good look when you say my dad says. why believe that? So I decided with a team that was working with a very famous author at the time, and still is, called Paul Devereux, I asked that team to join me at Avebury with a stone that's called in situ. That means that stone has never been re-erected and set in concrete, as some of the stones at Stonehenge and Avebury are. It's pure. It's been like that for nearly 5,000 years and has never, ever been toppled or moved. And he used some electromagnetic detecting equipment, and it went up the stone like this, and he made it audible. And so that when it hit any electromagnetic current coming out of the stone, it would give off like a buzz, like zzz, like that. So he put it up the stone, and I had to douse it first of all and mark it with a little bit of chalk that you can easily wipe off. And we went up, and exactly where we got the chakras and the energy bands, we got huge electromagnetic signals coming out categorically. And he put that through the statistical t-test, which scientists and the left brain people love, that we don't love, but it's needed sometimes in science. It came out 99.9% accurate. So when we interact with the stones, imagine that signal comes out at 18 hertz, because Rodney Hale measured it, very intelligent chap, and we hear at 20. What I discovered in the Stonehenge environs that I might touch upon later is I discovered all of the elongated skulled people of this area, that the Neolithic had very long skulls that went out that way. And I propose and hypothesize that these ancient people that built these structures could hear at 18 hertz. And we can't hear that signal because it's infrasound. But I think the ancient experience of the stones was hearing the energies, not just feeling the energies like we do today. It would have been a different experience. When you place your hands like this over band number 3, for example, which equates to the megalithic throat chakra, the energy is pouring into your body. It really is. And even if you do it for a couple of seconds, what Rodney did, he measured my electromagnetic energy field, my aura, if you will, before I put my hands on the stones and after. And it really did increase. Now, my late father and other dowsers besides always said this energy, when you leave, it could be just for 30 seconds, placing your hands like that on that energy pulse point. And when you leave Avery, the energy builds up in your system for 4 days. Imagine Avery energy building up, building up, and building up. So Rodney measured my auric field 4 days later, and it was right. It was building up all of the time. So I always say to people, you know, you don't need an hour therapy at Avery, believe me, or Stonehenge, 30 seconds on a stone, and you are going to go away with that energy within your auric field. And those that are sensitive, like you all, and those that are wisdom seekers, like us all, will often get downloads from this as well. And especially, you know, at the what's called the Greater Trilithon at Stonehenge. That's a real download stone. So we can see standing stones as having all of these sacred energy points. And it's so wonderful to interact with that. And the third eye, the fourth energy band above ground, because like I said, there's two below, beams out an energy signal to the next stone circle or the next outlying standing stone. So imagine this, you've got Stonehenge and you had, they're not there now, but you had lots of stones in between each energy site. They're beaming from one stone to another, creating an energetic network across the countryside. And I always say to guests, it's Wi-Fi. This is Neolithic Wi-Fi at its finest, because they did not need wires or anything like that. And a lot of people, when they place their hand just like that, pushing your hand up against a stone like that, a little bit away, you can feel those energy bands just like that. And I often take dowsing rods with me, and whoo, that will force the dowsing rod to go away or into the stone quite fast. And that's quite a good experience as well. There is a great chap in England. He's called Harry Oldfield. He did a lot of experiments with light detecting equipment and various other things alike. But in a nutshell, I went with one of his colleagues at a site not far from here called Wayland Smithy. And I live, incidentally, quite close to Avebury. I'm about 15 minutes away from Avebury, and I'm about 40 minutes away from Stonehenge. And Harry Oldfield said that he could get a camera filter and he could detect earth energy. And he knows I'm really pernickety about earth energy, other than anyone else in England. So I said, I'll show you one stone that will have it and one that won't. And if you can film that, then, you know, that will prove that the stones that are rooted into the earth energy emit these energy bands. And when he filmed it, the beautiful thing that he discovered was it was coming up, as I interpreted, in that chakra sequencing. It went from red at the bottom all the way up to violet at the top. So we can't hear the sounds coming from the stones because we haven't got long skulls, and we can't see that rainbow energy field. But when you're even led or stirred or by that stone, you're in a rainbow aura of the stone. And that's, again, a perception I suggest that the ancient ancestors could see. But we can photograph using these filters today, which I've done, and I use as part of my on-tour presentation in the field, as it were. Now, Stonehenge, what a place. Ravens meet you if you're with Vera at Stonehenge. And God knows what's going to happen when you all turn up in Star Wolf. They probably have a whole, I don't know, posse of birds there. I'm sure there will be a wonder. But I'm going to show you Stonehenge and the night of the high moon and how it was in phase one. And I'll describe that later. But this is Stonehenge. Stonehenge is a wonderful site. It contains huge, these megalithic structures are called trilithons. They have two stones with a stone on top, and a trilithon. They weigh about 95 tons. And there were five in the center, surrounded by a lintel stone circle of 30. That a lintel means two stones, and it had a perfect circular top to it. And today it is somewhat ruinous. But despite the fact that there are missing stones, it's energetically there. You can take a standing stone away, and they did at Avebury, and they did at Stonehenge, shockingly so, for building material and road rubble. But there, when you root a stone into that memorizing energy field, it leaves behind this like etheric image of itself. It's called remnants dowsing, if you're a dowser and you're using terminology. But just imagine that it's all still there energetically, as I know you all sense when you go there, and that you can still kind of interact with the monument in its totality. So it's still there, even though it's been pulled down, so to speak. Like that. I do want to point out to people as well, because what a lot of people don't know about Stonehenge is it is surrounded by 16 military establishments. It's called the Salisbury Plain, and the Salisbury Plain on which Stonehenge stands has all of these military establishments around it, just like in many other countries are the same. Now, the Salisbury Plain is owned by the Military of Defence. That means I can't go on it. So I can't go beyond that point because it's like Area 51 and it has a lot of military activity on it. So that's the side that English Heritage and the government do not want anyone to see. They don't want to see that because they know it has power. Now, the people of the past. On Vera's tour as well, in which Star Wolf, I'm sure, will wonder at this, as indeed you will all, this is called the West Kennet Long Barrow. And these are the monuments that the long-skulled people also built. They're like temples. An archaeologist will tell you, it's not a temple. It's just a place where they put buried burial deposits. It's all about death. everything to an archaeologist is always about death. It's never about life. It's never about energies. Even the King's Chamber, oh, it's all about death there too. And it's always 2500 BC, another date, an interpretation that they like. This is the West Kennet Long Barrow. It's the oldest monument in the ceremonial landscape of Avebury. It's wondrous. As you enter into it, it has four small chambers and a large chamber at the end, which you can stand up in and be surrounded by the megalithic energy. So you kind of enter through that, where that big stone is, and then you go down what's called the axis line, and then you come up to this amazing chamber, which has a lot of really powerful earth energy, has a mild vortex in there, not like a vortex at Sedona, which I've interacted with, but it does have a vortex energy. And again, people watch there. And what that, and I was only there the other day, and I said to a small group, just people watch, some people are coming in, we're going to go to one side, let's see where they go. Boom, they always go to the energy point because they kind of are attuned to it. So this is a wonderful site that your experience, if you do come on a tour with Vera and Star Wolf, and it is really one of the oldest. This predates Avebury in the stone circle phase by 1,000 years. This predates the Stonehenge that you are used to seeing with all the lintel stone circle going round by 1,000 years. These are the people of the past, and these were the people that had the long skulls, which I photographed at Cambridge University, and I'm currently writing a large book about their ancient culture and their ways. When we think about Stonehenge, we think about the sun. And that's stage two, okay? And this is stage two of Stonehenge. It has all of those lintels on. The Stonehenge we know. Just think of that as called Stonehenge stage two. And we are told continually that the heel stone that you see in front is aligned to the summer solstice sunrise. And it is. But it's a degree out. Any archaeo-astronomer would say, yeah, it does appear to rise above it, but it's not that 100% accurate. It's slightly off. And this is because the heel stone originally was aligned to the moon. And this is what archaeologists, again, they don't really put that out, but it's archaeo-astronomers know this to be true. That moonrise above the heel stone that happens every 9 years is equally and more accurate than the sunrise at the summer solstice. But we're all told, oh, it's Stonehenge, it's about the summer solstice, masculine energy. No, it's about the first phase was about the moon at Stonehenge. And how the ancients calculated it, you've got the heel stone just outside, and every 9 years, like I said, the moon, the full moon, stands right on top of that standing stone, massive full moon. But if it rises at that point in its cycle in the winter, it's that colour that you see before you. It's an eclipsed red moon above the heel stone. And that's been photographed by archaeoastronomers. The last time it was above there a few years ago, it was unfortunately cloudy and you couldn't see the eclipsed blood red moon above the heel stone. But in phase one, so we've got to imagine now that there's no lintels around Stonehenge. Stonehenge phase one was about the priestesses. It was about the moon. It was about the goddess, for example. And like I said, it was built by the long-skulled people. It was a matriarchal society because every single entrance then at Stonehenge was aligned to the moon. So the northeast had the heel stone there, the moon rising above it, the south entrance. Entrance at midnight, at the spring equinox and the autumn equinox, the full moon would align above that. And it originally had in phase one 56 blue stones, form a massive stone circle long before the Stonehenge were familiar with. They dismantled that and recreated it 500 years after this monument. And it had a bank, a ditch, and a bank. The bank was on the inside at Stonehenge, brilliant chalk white, set against highly polished bluestones. Now, bluestones come from Wales, and literally they were so polished, they looked like the star-spangled midnight sky. And if you come to me with Stonehenge, I'll show you highly polished bluestone, because today, that's a bluestone in the photograph in the middle. What you're saying to me, it doesn't look very star-spangled to me, but it does. Originally, it would have had a blue, midnight blue colour, little flexes of mica, and little flexes of feldspar, which are white dots that look like the star-spangled sky, and very, very polished, smooth to the touch. Today, the blue stones and the whole of Stonehenge looks rough, but originally it was very highly polished. And at Avebury, there is one stone left that is highly polished where I get people to touch it and they feel it and they go, oh my God, it's like velvet, Maria. It really is. It's so soft. Highly polished blue stone from Wales. 3 times more magnetic than any other stone in the British Isles. And this is the lunar midpoint cycle that I want to show you of the moon rising above the heel stone when seen from the center of that stone circle I've just shown you, or today from the center of Stonehenge. It's called its mid swing position. And that happens every 9 years. Okay, it will rise above it. And I've seen it. And then it will move to the left, creating what's called a major standstill, and then it moves to the other side. And it's the way the moon moves over 18.61 years. It's very powerful. And we're coming up to a point where the moon is going to be at its most northerly. Okay, this is when the goddess moon is at her most powerful, and it only happens every 18.61 years. Now, that high moon, so imagine in the moon's metonic cycle, as it's called, don't let these words kind of, bother you. Imagine this, the moon is at its most northerly, yeah? That's in one particular point. But it also can be at its biggest, in its most southerly, when it's low and rising. But at Stonehenge, in the first phase, with those 56 blue stones going around, it was aligned to the year of the high moon. Okay, and there's another side that, if I have time in a moment, I'll talk to you about, because it is the most powerful place to see the moon's most southerly, moonrise. Now, so we've got to imagine there's these 56 stones going around, and we've got 19 and 19 and 18, which adds up to 56 blue stones, and that's the years of the high moon. And it's a time when it will open up portals. It's a time when it opens up the earth energies. It's a time when the female earth energies course across the world with power. And it is immensely, immensely powerful, because I've been dowsing for over 2 moons metonic cycle now. And it's opposite to the summer solstice. It's the long, which is the longest day. This is the longest night of the moon. These are henges, and it's baffled, which means just ditch and bank, like I said earlier, and then they're monuments. And it's always baffled archaeologists, is why do they have these funny corners? And why do they have these funny arcs around them? And I studied that with an astronomer, and we've come up to the conclusion with an engineer and solved the puzzle of henges, and it relates to the night of the high moon at particular sites. Now, Stonehenge is different to any other henge monument in the British Isles. It's different to Avebury, it's different to Mount Pleasant, and it's different to Marden. They're super henges, because Stonehenge has its bank on the inside, not on the outside. That's what happens at Avebury. And I always question these anomalies at ancient sites. I just ask the ancestors, why? Why did you do that? And over a course of time, I believe that I was guided by the ancestors, and they told me why. Now, This is called a caustic curve, and it's quite exciting because it does something really beautiful at places like Stonehenge and other places besides. So chalk is white, it's highly reflective. And if you put a beam of light onto chalk, it creates either a line or a caustic effect, which is like that kind of arc. That's what the light will do. So it makes that shape of light. It's like a curve, but it's a light. So just imagine that you've got a reflective surface, highly polished, and a beam of light hits that and will make that shape or long line in the landscape. That's what it will do against a reflective surface. That is science and that is fact. And when we come to places like Stonehenge with the bank on its outside, it was so highly polished. And again, you see it grass covered. In fact, you don't even see the henge at Stonehenge anymore because it's only about 4 feet now. And it used to be 10 feet high. It was massive chalk bank, highly, highly polished, with the bank curiously on the outside. And one of the custodians of the site, which was like our witness, said it was like a massive bowl of and when he was at an excavation back in the 50s, it's a UNESCO World Heritage Site now, which means you can't dig there, and as an archaeologist for no good reason, he saw it in its highly polished, pristine state, and he said it was a sight to behold. Now, this is the effect that I'm going to say to you. Imagine that you're at Stonehenge, it's night, it's the night of the high moon, for example, and you're stood in the center, then you're going to see some beautiful caustic effects. That's how the light is going to shine at Stonehenge, because the floor of Stonehenge is grass covered today. Originally, archaeologists know that it was chalk white. Everything was white. It looked like there were a huge full moon above. Everything was white. The floor, the bank. And now you're stood at the center of Stonehenge phase one. And when the moon comes round about 8:30 in the evening, on the night of the high moon, it would hit one of those corners and start reflecting this huge beam of light across the ground. And could you imagine if there was a priestess stood in that beam of light and it was coursing across the ground to roughly about the just before what's called the Z and Y holes, which is a feature at Stonehenge. Just imagine that beam of light is heading towards you. And that's where the number one is. So that would be another beam. And then the moon moves round the site. And then again, at site number two, you have what's called a standing stone, a station stone. And the moon would have lit that stone up. And it would look beautiful. And again, I envision a priestess stood there and receiving that light on the stone. Or maybe she just stood by it and was momentarily lit up by it. And it's such a fast effect. It won't last that long. And then everything goes back to the darkness again. And the moon, as it moves around the henge in the night sky, at number three, we would have, again, that caustic line effect going across the ground. Somebody could have been stood by one of those beautiful, highly polished blue stones and have been lit up in the moonlight. So that's a long lost lunar alignment that I've discovered alongside some experts, because I'm always looking into the ancient sites and what they used to do in terms of visual things. And this is the heel stone where the moon rises above it. This was a long ago excavation where they found it too was in a circle. So that circle was filled in with chalk. So you have the heel stone in a little white circle as well, reflecting the moon above. But today you see it all as grass covered, so you don't see that which was. That's why I like to relive these events and talk about them. And even in Stonehenge, which we know today, it still has all of these lunar alignments associated with it, like the minor northern moonrise and the major northern moonrise as well. And that's the whole cycle of 18.61 years. And we're coming up to an hour, and so I'll speak for a little bit longer. Then I'll invite any questions that anybody wants to talk about, or any of their feelings. But this is a wonderful lunar site, and I find it a slightly irritating when people just talk about the sun at Stonehenge, and they disregard the moon, and in that they're disregarding the goddess aspect about this ancient site, which was, like I say, I think there was priestesses here. And I, like I said earlier, I discovered the long-headed ones of Stonehenge. And this was a woman. She was quite small. These people weren't very tall. She was 4'9", about the same height as Queen Nefertiti of Egyptian fame. And she had a long skull going this way and quite a narrow face, quite identical to the long skull people found in Malta. And she must have been one of the high queens of Stonehenge, because she was placed in the largest long barrow in Northwest Europe, which is nearly 400 feet long, huge. And normally there would be lots of other barrows around, but it wasn't. She was crowning a hilltop, and it was dedicated just to her, which is actually quite unusual in the ancient landscape. So this is her kind of long skull. And like I said, I've been talking for about an hour, I think, so I'll go on for a little bit longer and then take some questions. But the most important thing about going into an ancient site is finding the neutral point. What's a neutral point? It's called a neutral point, incidentally, which I'll describe in a moment, by male dowsers. They don't ever seem to come up with any pretty names, do they? Oh, it's got to be a neutral point. I always think, you know, they could have come up with a little bit something more inventive. But anyway, it's a neutral point. So at places, whether you're at the Sphinx Temple, the Pyramids, Stonehenge, wherever, one should ideally go to the neutral point, because it's a point in the ancient site which has this massive outpouring of negative ions and energy. We've measured it. We know it's negative ions. And it kind of pours out. And it's called the neutral point. But what it does, it kind of cleanses your energy system before you enter the site. So these neutral points are found just outside of the ancient site itself. Back in the day, 4,500 years ago, 5,000 years ago, the ancients would have gone to these sites, cleansed themselves, so they did not take their polluting energies into the site, you know, like their emotional energy into the site. So the site will be kept pure by interacting with these neutral points. So it's very important. And again, when we're at Avebury, I take people to the neutral point. They feel the energy and they feel bathed in the energy. You feel bathed in the energy and you feel fresh from the inside out. It's a wonderful stone at Avebury. There's a great point at Stonehenge, quite close to the Healstone, which is a wonderful place. And then you enter the site with all of your energy field clear, and you don't pollute the site, so to speak. So I'm coming to the end of the presentation now, but like I said at the beginning, I think in these times, it's really good to think about things that may help us in some way. And the ancient Egyptians left us some amazing energy pendulums. This is the Isis pendulum, which is double barreled. If you're thinking about getting one, then you look for 6-bar double-barreled Isis pendulum. And as we see at the moment, by itself, it will start spinning. If you place this pendulum over something, it's not for like information dowsing or asking questions. Say you place the Isis pendulum over, for example, a glass of water, it will start going clockwise, or anti-clockwise. And if it goes clockwise, it's putting in the white light, the sun god Ra, or white light energy. And if it goes counterclockwise, it's taking out toxins, dark toxins. And you can use it to heal the body. And it's related to what's called the esoteric colors of the sun god Ra. Because the ancient Egyptians knew that at particular times of the day, wow, for example, at this time we're in daylight saving time, so at 1 p.m. in the afternoon, the green ray is dominant and comes down at particular times of the day, particular colors. Just imagine that. And these pendulums were found in the 1930s whilst excavating the Valley of the Kings. And here we have a depiction of the Isis pendulum here, which they're always being held by the priesthood. They got cobras on, the kind of helmet, and they breathe into these pendulum energy devices. And incidentally, this one goes down to the ground. It's got a fork at the bottom like that, and it's being pushed into what I believe are the earth energies. They're always breathing into the device, and they're breathing the Ankh symbol, which means the life force, healing energy. And this is at a wondrous temple called Abydos. And it's beautiful color. And when you're kind of getting to be understanding the colors coming down from the sun, it's a wonderful ancient ritual that you do with your pendulum. You unscrew the double bar and you breathe in that color of Ra into the energy device of the Isis pendulum. You don't have to do that, because it will just emit white light anyway, which contains all of the colors of the sun god Ra. But it is a wonderful little energy device. And this is for those that might be interested in taking a course with me. I run esotericcollege.com, and I have lots of dowsing courses and things like that. And you can go onto the internet and find your own Isis pendulum, or you can go on to my other website, theaveburyexperience.co.uk, and I also sell them. And I put them in because they're not that expensive, and they can charge up food, and they can take out toxins as well. And so this is just a great little healing energy device, like I said, that was rediscovered at the Valley of the Kings by French diviners in the 1930s, which I think is a gift from ancient Egypt to us today. And I love my Isis pendulum device. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this presentation from Avebury to Glastonbury to Stonehenge, and a little bit of Egypt thrown in at the end for a little bit of healing, and looking at some of the lost lunar alignments of Stonehenge and the earth energies and the megalithic energies of the ancient sites. I'll stop sharing.
Wow, my dear, that was amazing. Even though I have been there, I felt like so much, you know, when we hear again and again and again, it just feel like, wow, it sinks deeper and deeper. Beautiful. I will stop the recording because I think when I download it, it's going to be a little too long. So just a minute. Stop recording.